supernatural deliverance, supernatural favor, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you, we praise you, we ask you, in the name of Jesus, we glorify you, we thank you right now. We thank you for the anointing in this room. We thank you in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you. We thank you. Lord, 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 we thank you. Lord,
when you got your music now, but right now you got this. But when you're ready, go.
We're gonna
disconnect it.
We gotta go. Yeah, because we're gonna be starting.
Okay. Take it out. Turn the music off.
Bless their homes in the name of Jesus.
Ready? Because we gotta plug it in anyway.
That they're blessed coming in. They're blessed coming out. Lord, we thank you right now. Supernatural favor. The finances are going to take place. The finances are going to increase. Healing is going to take place. Salvation is going to take place. In the name of Jesus. Lord, we lift you up and we magnify you right now. In the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for your anointing. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you for your anointing. In the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you. We praise you. We honor you. We give you the highest praise. Hallelujah. 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 Praise our sacred souls. Lord, we thank you because you promised us that you will never leave us nor forsake us, but that you will be with us until the end. Lord, we thank you. We honor you today. In the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you right now that everything that is trying to come against the agenda of God, it shall not take place. In the name of Jesus. We come to take authority in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you right now because you have chosen us from the foundation of the world. In the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you right now that you are here and that we're here for such a time as this. Lord, we thank you right now. And we glorify you and we magnify you in the name of Jesus. And just find your still all these things right now.
We've all come together from different places. Isn't that beautiful? Hallelujah, like a body. The body of Yeshua HaMashiach. Yes, give him glory. Hallelujah. Lift up a sound. Lift up a sound of praise. In his place. Lift you up, Lord. Thank you. God, we wish you'd come.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. I mean, God's not into self-righteous religion. He said, "Well, those who have a pure heart, they shall see God." Amen.
And they are all against the nation of Israel, and the only two that are really before it that could cause some problems, they've got to determine what can they do about these two witnesses.
Hold your ground now. The more we hold our ground, the more we show and reveal to the world how much evil there's going on right now, the brighter the bride becomes.
The Satan can get your thinking wrong. He can get your emotions wrong.
Well, I was standing in front of a grandfather clock, and I saw the clock was midnight, and all of a sudden I began to hear bong, bong, and it bonged three times. Nine more bones that were left. When I woke up, the Lord says, "That is how close you are to my coming for you.
Help! Come help me! Help me rescue the perishing! Help me rescue the perishing!"
And they laughed and mocked.
Praise the Lord. Glory. Hallelujah. Can we get those curtains open for right now? Are you gonna need those curtains closed, right, for your presentation? Okay. Alrighty. Praise the Lord.
seeing the light. Glory. Hallelujah. Thank you guys for joining. This is Hamish Kondavi, the Tabernacle of David. Can we give the Lord a hand? We want to thank and praise Yeshua Ministries from Arizona for joining us in worship this morning. It really took the pressure off of me, so I didn't have to do it. Bring in another anointing because we bring our anointing together. And for all of you who are joining us on live stream, are you live streaming, yeah, Pastor Paul? Yeah. Okay, so Pastor Paul is, where's Pastor? Oh, wow, we got three different things going at one time. Well, God bless everybody who is watching on live stream and Periscope. We are sorry that we were a little late. You know, the enemy tries, but he has no foot in the door. We have the victory. Amen. Amen. And so I'm sorry if you guys don't like loud worship. We like worship, and we are a mixture of Jewish believers, spirit-filled, and Christians that come together to worship the Lord. Amen. And so I want to say hi to all of my live streamers who follow me on live stream. God bless you, and may the Lord bless you on today as you continue to watch. Now, we did start a little bit late, and again, what we're probably going to do is we have one particular speaker that was supposed to come in on live screen today. He was supposed to Skype in, and there really hasn't been much in the way of communication. So, and that is Brother Maurice Gabar. I don't know if he's actually going to be joining us, and I do apologize for that. We hope everything is okay with him. But we do have Rabbi Stephen Ben-Denoon, who will be Skyping in from Israel, and that'll be a little bit later. So we have some time, and what we're going to do is we're going to pray for our sister Heidi, and she is not feeling well. Now, I do have to warn you, I am Jewish, but I have a big mouth when it comes to praying and believing God for things. I'm not quiet, and I do not apologize for that. We have to be radical. The Word of God says that the kingdom of God, what?
Suffers
much, right? But the violent take it by force. And sometimes we are too passive. We have to get violent. We are in the last days. And when I mean violent in the spirit. Okay? When it comes to worship, when it comes to prayer, when it comes to intercessory prayer, when it comes to walking by faith. So I want to encourage each and every one of you. Thank you guys for joining me last night for Shabbat. The anointing was so strong. Yes. It was really, the presence of God was there. We're going to have an altar call a little bit later, and we're going to be praying for people. So those of you who are watching on Pastor Paul, sending your prayer requests, we're going to be praying for souls. Those of you on live stream, and what is that again?
Periscope.
Send in your prayer requests. If they can send in prayer requests to you guys, we're going to just come and we're going to bombard heaven, okay? What we're going to do a little bit later is we're going to break at 5. Everybody's going to have to leave. And then we're going to have you guys come back around 6 o'clock so the tables will be set for the Passover. So for anybody who would like to join us for Passover on live stream, wherever you are watching, have all of your components. And God bless you and thank you. Hi, Kathy. I see you there, sister. God bless you. Sister Tammy and your mom, all of you who watch me on live stream, every viewer, God bless you. May the presence of God touch you on today. So what we're going to do is we're going to call up Minister Heidi, and we're going to lay hands on her, and we are going to pray for her. Come on, Heidi. You okay to come up, or would you like to sit down in a chair? Okay. Can we bring a chair up for her? And the ministers that are here, so the speakers, if I can ask Pastor Paul, you guys to just come on up, and we're going to lay hands on her. And you guys that are out there, please be in prayer. You know, I was feeling really sick this morning myself, and let me tell you, it had to go. We don't have time. We don't have time for sickness in our body. And this is a mighty woman of God. She's got too many things. They were just coming from
where?
Decatur. Decatur, Illinois. Yeah, and so they've been traveling quite a bit. And, you know, going from one place to another, ministry can wear you out. And we're going to pray over you. Can I cover you with Shelly? Thank you, Lord. Let's anoint her hands. Pastor Paul, this is your wife, so we're going to ask you to lay hands on her. We're going to come in agreement. Everybody. everybody, please stretch your hands toward our sister. Those that you are watching and live streaming in Periscope, please stretch your hands.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we just thank you, Lord, right now. We lay hands on our sister, Lord. You said if there be any sick among us,
yes,
that we can call for the elders of the church, anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. And you said, Lord, the prayer of faith shall save the sick. The Lord shall raise them up.
Yes.
And any sin that's committed shall be forgiven. We come to her now, Lord. We say, Lord, in the name of Jesus, that by your stripes we are healed.
Yes, yes.
And we thank you, Lord, for the power of the anointing, Lord, that breaks every yoke.
Yes, Lord.
We lay hands in the spirit of agreement here today.
Yes.
We call upon the name of Jesus, name of Yeshua,
Hallelujah.
The Messiah.
Yes,
and Lord,
Lord,
we thank you, Father,
thank you,
that through this great anointed
yes.
power, the healing
Hallelujah.
Comes.
Yes,
in Jesus' name.
Yes,
thank you,
Lord.
Lord.
Yes, Lord. We bind sickness.
Yes.
We
yes.
bind sickness in this body today
yes,
in the mighty
Jesus.
Name of Yeshua HaMashiach. We do not receive sickness. Lord, we
thank,
thank you,
Lord.
That this is the day of
yes.
Passover.
Yes,
and so
Lord.
We decree in the
yes.
name of Yeshua
yes.
that
yes,
the
Lord.
Angel of death and sickness and
yes.
disease
yes.
have
thank
to
you,
pass over
yes.
our
Hallelujah.
Sister
yes.
today.
Praise
as we decree the blood
yes,
of Jesus
Lord.
Over
praise
her
you, Lord.
From the top of her head to the soles of her feet.
Yes,
Lord, we just decree
Lord.
And declare
yes.
in the
yes.
mighty name
yes.
of Jesus that she is
healed
from
Hallelujah.
The head to,
yes.
to the toe, Lord,
yes.
from the inside
yes.
out and
yes,
from the
Lord.
Outside
thank
in.
You, Lord.
We thank you for clarity of
yes.
mind, Lord. And we thank you before this day
thank
is out.
Lord.
Our sister
yes.
is healed. That
yes.
she will be dancing.
Yes.
She will be teaching
yes.
and preaching
yes.
and declaring the
yes.
word of the Lord,
yes.
Father God. We give you glory, Lord,
yes.
that on
yes,
their
Lord.
Next
yes.
assignment,
yes.
Father God, she will go in with that power
yes.
and that authority
yes.
that you
Lord.
Have placed inside
yes.
of her, Lord. And that word that is in her
yes.
belly
yes.
to
yes.
speak, Father God.
Yes.
We thank you for
Lord.
Rivers of living
thank
water,
you.
Father, to
yes,
begin to flow out of
yes,
this mighty
Lord.
Woman of God.
Thank
and we bind every source
yes.
of witchcraft, voodoo,
yes.
hex,
yes.
in the name of
yes.
Jesus.
Jesus.
Every
name.
Wicked word, evil
yes.
word that has
you
been spoken against her.
Name.
We speak in the name
yes.
of Yeshua
yes,
that your words will
yes.
die.
Yes.
We speak life over her right now.
Yes.
We decree
Jesus.
The life
yes.
of Yeshua and the shalom of Yeshua HaMashiach. As we are also on the Sabbath, in the Sabbath,
yes.
resting in
yes.
the Sabbath,
yes.
the Shabbat Shalom, we speak the Messianic anointing.
Yes.
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 And we just thank you for this. We give you all glory to have your name today, Holy Spirit. And Lord, we just thank you.
Thank
she,
you.
Lord, we call it done. And we
yes.
say amen and amen.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Pastor Paul, do you want to say something before we turn it over to Brother Bob? Okay, we're going to flow. We're going to go with the flow. Like I said, our other speaker has not called in, which is okay. So we're really kind of going by the Holy Spirit, okay? And that's what we want. We want the Spirit of God to lead. So if you came in grumpy, lumpy, chumpy, rumpy, we're going to send you out glorious, happy, joyful, slap you around a little bit, you know, throw that Holy Ghost all over you. By the end of the day, you'll be all right. Amen. And so we praise God for that. We want everybody. We are to come. The Lord says make a joyful noise unto the Lord, you know. And so we're not supposed to come into his presence grumpy. And if we are grumpy, you know, the Spirit of God come upon you, each and every one of you, and restore you, restore your soul. Amen?
Yeah.
All right, so real quick before I turn it over to Brother Bob. Now, we're going to have to use Pastor Paul's live stream at 11:45 to 12:45 now. For those of you guys that are watching on live stream, at 11:45, right before 11:45, my live stream will go down, okay? And the reason is because I can't use my camera to live stream and to have
Skype,
okay? So we're going to go down, and shortly before 11:45, for those of you who are watching, go to my website, www.hamishkandavid.org, or just look up Rabbi Leora. You will find me on the internet. You want to go to the home page, and then on there, you want to click on Brother Paul's link. His live stream is up and running. So you're going to, we're kind of doing a little tag team here, right? Switch over to there. And then right after Brother Danoon, he is going to be done finishing up around 12:45. Around 1 o'clock, We got Pastor Bob and Pastor Larry coming on at around 1. So then we'll be switching right back to here at 1 o'clock, okay? And from 1 to 5, just to kind of let you guys know, from 1 to 5, we will have the live stream here. At 5 o'clock, we're going to break, and then we will come back at 6 o'clock. We're going to live stream from here so that we can have or begin the Passover Seder for you guys, all right? So God bless you, and stay tuned. Make sure everybody can hear Morning Shalom. Started late, about time. Okay. Tammy. Hi, Tammy, and Mom, and Jocelyn. Everybody's sending messages. Love you guys. I hope you guys can hear everything. Okay, so you may have to adjust your volume. And we are going to open this up. Are you sure you don't want the curtains closed?
Not right now.
Okay.
No, I don't need them closed yet.
Alrighty. Well, you are all set on.
You guys can hear me pretty good right now. Without my mic, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Testing? Testing. I'm turning on now. This one here has a longer battery. This one has a fresh battery in it.
Just remember that.
I can start talking now. Hi, my name is Bob Barber. Some of you guys might know who I am. That's good to know. But I have a channel on YouTube. It's called End Time Dream and Vision. And actually, it's under Bob Barber. But if you put my name, Bob Barber, like a barbershop, you'll see my channel. Okay, or just Google my name, Bob Barber. And my area of expertise is dealing with dreams and visions. And it is a moment.
In your best pocket.
That's called. Okay. Oh, good idea.
There you go.
Testing, testing.
No.
Testing. It's on, I know. Testing. 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 Here. Working now?
Yeah. Picking up.
Testing.
No.
Testing. 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 On this one now. Testing. You guys, we're up here for an hour. How long are we here for, Ruben? 2 hours of stuff up? Nothing was working. evidently, the Satan has his minions here. They're not going to like what we're going to talk about, evidently. Right? There's an unusual amount of demonic activity over this hotel right now. So let's, we got to pray right now, because I need prayer. We all need prayer. All speakers need prayer. Does that sound good? Testing.
There you go.
It's good.
Turn it all the way.
Good. Testing.
Yeah.
Testing. Testing. Testing.
Yeah. You're good.
I have to put it on the outside. Maybe that's why it's getting in the way. Testing. 1, 2, 3.
Yeah.
I think it's because of it in my coat pocket. Okay. So evidently there's a demonic activity outside this place right now. I know it's here. They don't like what we're doing right now, so we just gotta pray now in Yeshua's name. Father in heaven, right now we command in Yeshua's name, we bind every unclean spirit as we're trying to get into the place and mess with this equipment, mess with our minds, mess with our voices, mess with our bodies, to start sicknesses. We rebuke all those things in Yeshua's name. We command all these unclean spirits to be silenced and be bound. And now open up the abyss. We now cast them down to the abyss. In Yeshua's name. You hear that, you filthy Raphaim? You come anywhere near this hotel, you're going down to the abyss. I'm leaving that abyss open. And anywhere within a 50-mile radius, you come to this hotel, you will go into the abyss automatically. We command it to stay open for the next 8 hours. In Yeshua's name. Amen. There's a vortex over this building right now. There is a vortex. We can't see it, but it's here. Okay, we're going to stay away. So anyway, my name is Bob Barber, and I started my channel about 2 years ago, and I was here last year. I don't know if you guys remember me. But basically, I'm going to be talking about dreams and visions, and it's kind of funny because how things are changing right now. Originally, I was to be doing with Pastor Larry here, but evidently we have more time. So I'm kind of changing everything as I go, but I'm going to be following my outline. But I'm going to be talking about the rapture today, okay? So I'll just get right into it here. 1 Thessalonians 4:16-17. For the Lord shall descend from heaven with a shout, the voice of an archangel, and the trump of God. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we, which are alive and remain, shall be caught up together to meet them in the clouds, to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. 1 Corinthians 15:51-54. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed in the moment, the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. This is a funny that it says at the last trump. Okay, a lot of us know about the beast of trumpets, right? Oh, if there's a last trump, there has to be a first trump. Right? And at the last trump, well, there has to be a first trump. Okay? And you know, the beast of trumpets is a Ruby might help me out here. I know there's 100 trumpets, and the final trumpet, the Tekiah HaGadolah, waxing loud and long. Okay, that's the final trumpet, all right? Now, let me get back here. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead in Christ shall rise, then the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. John 14:3, and if I go to prepare a place for you, I come again, and I will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. Okay? 1 Thessalonians 1:10. And to wait for his son from heaven, whom he has raised from the dead, Yeshua, who delivers us from the wrath to come. What wrath is to come? A 7-year tribulation. We are not appointed to wrath. The bride of Christ is not appointed to wrath. The church is not appointed to wrath. Right? Yeshua is not going to be up his bride and bring her to heaven. Okay, that's not going to happen. And I'm going to explain why I believe that. Okay. Now, Hebrews 12:22-23, the last rapture verse I want to share with you. But you have come to Mount Zion, to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem. All right, the heavenly Jerusalem. We're not on an earthly Jerusalem no more. He's addressing those who are resurrected, the resurrected saints, and those who are living on the earth. This is how he addresses them. But you have come to the Mount Zion, heaven. Mount Zion, to the heavenly Jerusalem, to an innumerable number of angels. There ain't no angels, appearing around us right now. What's the innumerable amount of angels? Where they are? They're going to be in the third heavens. Okay? And
in festal gathering, and to the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, the firstborn. The firstborn are those who have received their immortal bodies. They are made perfect. They're the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven. All right? Okay, you're enrolled in heaven. Your name's in the book of life, Lamb's book of life. That's the heavenly registry. If your name's not in there, you're not going into third heavens. Plain and simple. All right? The Bible's clear about that. Enrolled in heaven and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of righteous men made perfect. Righteous men made perfect. Once again, our bodies are reunited with our spirits. Now, a lot of people say how that's going to happen. Paul says mystery, guys. We don't know. We don't know how it's going to happen. But I do know this. From seeing the dreams and visions, one man in particular, I'll never forget this. He said that he saw every single molecule of your body. Like someone takes your body, you die, and they take your body, they turn it to ash, then they throw it out to the sea. Okay? He saw that every single molecule of your body was reunited, recreated your body. Bible said we go back to the earth, back to dust. All the dust molecules, he saw them all come back together. The dust molecules that made Pastor Larry, all right?
Yep.
The dust molecules that made me, they all came back together and formed that body, all right? Or I heard another way to explain it to you, he takes a piece of DNA from your body and reconstructs a completely brand new body, an immortal body. And I'm going to be getting into that too, all right? A body that can travel at speed of light, faster than speed of light. In fact, the speed of light, come to think of it right now, speed of light, no one knows, is could travel, an angel could travel at the speed of light. The speed of light could travel around the earth 7.5 times in 1 second. In 1 second. But even at the speed of light, if an angel was to travel from here to the third heavens, because right now, the third heavens is on the outer part, outer parts of our galaxy right now. Okay? And the Bible explains how that's laid out. First heavens from this ground here to the highest mountain in the clouds. That's the first heavens. This is where Satan's operating. The second heavens between our atmosphere and the earth to the edge of our galaxy. That's the second heavens. And then the third heavens, that's where Elohim, our Father in heaven, is at. But think of an angel traveling at the speed of light. Can't get there that fast. Even at the speed of light, it'll take thousands of years for that angel to get there. So the angels actually, angels, and I'm saying angels, we soon to be. So the Bible says that Yeshua said when we're resurrected, we will be like the angels. The Bible says when we see Yeshua, we shall be like him. Okay? Which means we will travel actually faster than the speed of light. We'll travel at the speed of thought. Which is quantum speed. Which is take speed of light and throw it into a quantum deal. And it can't be explained. By the speed of thought, we'll be here. Larry, the Father has called us to heaven. We must go. We just traveled across the galaxy in 1 second, probably quicker than that, by the speed of thought. Okay, and we know that that's the case because the Bible even says that when Gabriel came to Daniel and he was praying, he said it took him 21 days to get there. It didn't take him 21 days to travel. No, it took him 21 days to fight off the principalities that were in the sky. They had to call him Michael, all right, to clear the way. But it took him. He got here quickly, instantly. But keep in mind, as I prayed at the beginning, there is a demonic activity that's surrounding this earth right now. And I believe in the catching away of the saints, that if that's why we just don't know the day or hour. Because if we did, Satan would know too. And Satan knew what day and what hour and what second our Lord was coming, he would surround the earth with his demon. They'll hold a chain across this earth and that we're ready. Bring it. Like the Romans did. They just walked. They just surrounded. They tried to make it through. But that's not going to happen. When the Lord comes and gets us, it's going to be a flashlight twinkling. And I will go. Be removed. We'll be outside the earth quickly. And Satan, where'd they go? You know. But now here's the other thing, too. When that happens, the principalities don't know, too. If you know why. Because the hand of the restrainer that's on them, they're going to realize, hey, I can start moving now. You ever go to a dream? And you're trying to get away, you're like this, something's restraining me. I can't run. But once the hand of restrainer moves, those guys will start booking. The Bible says in chapter 9, Revelation 9:3, that they'll come out of the abyss. Alright? So when they come out of the abyss, they gotta have free reign. Okay. So I know I'm rabbit trailing here a lot. But go to the next part here. theological word, rapture. All right? That's a big, I tell you what, the word rapture probably divides more Christians than anything. It does. And there's a reason. It's by design. That's why it divides us all. It's by design. All right? So you got people who believe in mid-trip, post-trip, and also people who believe in pre-trip, which is where I am. And I'll explain why the mid-trip works here in a minute. There's some water here real quick. I'm so sorry to get dry already. Now, the word rapture is not in the English translation. Okay? Sorry, it's not in the English translation. But you know what, though? It is in the Latin translation. It's the word rapira, or rapere, or raptus. That is in the Latin translation. Right? It's just not in the English translation. English-speaking people are having trouble with this word. All right? But if that word doesn't work, I got some other ones you can choose from. You can do the General Assembly of the Firstborn, Hebrews 12:23, caught up. 2 Thessalonians 4:16, the gathering together, 2 Thessalonians 2:1, the resurrection, the catching away, carried away, taken up, caught away. In Hebrew, does anybody know what the rapture is called in Hebrew? The Nekhatah. They have a name, the Hebrew people have a name for it. It's called the Nekhatah. All right? But they have a name for it. Now, I'd like to talk a little bit about those who don't believe in the rapture. Okay? That's another thing. Once again, those we have the dividing line of pre-trip, post-trip, and mid-trip and post-trip. They got that divided. Then you got people who just won't believe in it. Alright, there's some speaker I know of right now. He speaks behind a blue screen, and he's a big renowned speaker all around this country. And the owner of Walmart paid him millions and millions of dollars to stay online so he could continue to preach that there is no rapture. Yeah. And I can't remember his name. I remember reading about him. And he's paid millions and millions of dollars. And this guy right here is where everybody's getting their teaching from. And what's amazing is this, that from my studies and other studies of people I've seen, that the Bible says in Isaiah 28, chapter 28, verse 10, I believe, that you build a doctrine that's a precept upon precept, mm-hmm. precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little, there a little. Mm-hmm. If that's how you build a doctrine. The word is hidden. The word is hidden, and it's deeply hidden. But that's why we have the Holy Spirit. And you can get a deeper revelation in the word, depending on how deep you want to go. Okay? We can all read the Bible. We can all have the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit said, everything I know right now, I can go deeper into the Word, get greater, greater, greater revelation in this on the same passage, on the same scripture. It all depends how deep you want to go. But that's the way the Word is designed, right? Yeshua came here, he was speaking in parables. Mm-hmm. It's hidden once again for a reason. All right? Now, unbelief about the rapture. Okay? I guess I have time to explain this right now. So much stuff that I've been putting in my outline. I didn't think I had enough time to explain it. Hebrews chapter 3, chapter 4. 11 times if Paul talks about the word rest. Okay? 11 times. But 10 out of the 11 times he says the word rest. If you read the Greek translation, I still got it here, right? If you read the Greek translation, rest, 10 times he used the word anapao. Anapao means to lie down, rest, relax, and repose. All right? It also refers to the convocation having your eternal rest when you die. Okay? But one time, and it's in chapter 4, he mentions the word rest, but in the Greek translation, he used the word sabbatismos. Okay? Sabbatismos. And what he's referring to, not going to a long teaching about that, what he's referring to is a Sabbath rest. It's different from all the other rest. He's keep referring to your heavenly rest, your heavenly rest, your heavenly rest. If you read that chapter, it's all about your heavenly rest. But one time he goes into a Sabbath rest. And what he's referring to there is the catching away of the church. All right? And right there he says, I believe, brethren, I'm paraphrasing here right now. I warn you, brethren, do not have an unbelieving heart. Do not have an evil, unbelieving heart. A heart of unbelief. But you will fall away from the living God. Alright? Unbelieving heart. Meaning that you won't believe in the catching away. Alright? So he's warning them. Alright? Keep believing. As crazy as it sounds, and I tell you what, the Bible says it, and it's right there. And I just named, I can probably pull about 30 more verses for you guys that talks about the catching away of the church. And I'm going to be, like I said about the book of Isaiah, precept, line upon line, okay, parallel, they call it a parallel, types, patterns, numbers, symbols. And you start doing all those studies, all right, the pre-tribulation rapture, all patterns, parallels, types, symbols point at pre-trib, but nothing points at mid-trib, nothing points at post-trib. But there are verses that point at mid-trib and post-trib, but parallels and patterns point at pre-trib. And I'm going to be talking about how that lines up, and of course when Larry comes up, he's going to be talking about that too as well. But going back to what Paul is saying, if you don't believe in the rapture, all right, let me put you this way. We have a lot of healing going on here this weekend. Right? Amen?
Amen.
Now, if you don't believe in the blessing of God, can you be a part of that blessing? No. If you don't believe God can heal you, can you be healed? If you don't believe that you can be sanctified from your sins, can you be sanctified? No. If you don't believe in salvation, can you be saved?
No.
No. If you don't believe in speaking in tongues, will you ever speak in tongues? No. Yeshua's not going to come down to the angel. He's not going to do that. I remember I was trying to preach. I was like, I want to speak in tongues. I've been praying, but I could just send somebody to start shaking my lips. Imagine I got there. So if you don't believe in those blessings, you're not particular. So what happens when you say, I don't believe in the rapture? Are you going to go in it? No, you won't. You won't go in it. Will you go to heaven when you die? Yeah, because you believe in the blood of Jesus. When you die, you believe in that blood. It will save you. Your name is in heaven, heavenly registry. Alright? But you're not, you will go to heaven. You believe in that. The rapture is a special blessing for the overcomers. And if you want to know about what you need to do to prepare yourself for the rapture, just read the first three verses of Revelation. Seven messages of overcome. Just read it. Seven times he tells the churches how to overcome. It's the overcomers, all right, that go in the rapture. Some people preach today, oh, yeah, you know, and that's where we're all divided here, too. Everybody goes in the rapture. Everybody goes. No, that's not how it works. Everybody that calls themselves a believer, I'm washing the blood of Jesus. Do they all go in the rapture? No. But those... And I'll explain why, you know, you can be that person and say, I believe I got the blood of Jesus. I know people who have the blood of Jesus, they're full of the Holy Ghost, but they don't believe in the rapture. So guess what? You're not going to take part in that blessing. You're going to be the unprofitable servant that the Bible warns about in the parables, that when the rapture happens, you're going to be thrown in the outer darkness. And it's funny that the parables are talking about believers. The good servant, the bridesmaid, the wise, the foolish. The servant, the unprofitable servant. They're all servants. But why did Yeshua kept on beating that into their brains? Because there was going to come a time when there would be a generation. I believe this is the generation that we're not going to see death, for the most part. I believe it. And it's such a cutting. What's that verse we talk about, Larry? That verse that fine Yeshua.
The word of God is quick and powerful. Sharper than any two-edged sword.
Amen.
Is able to divide between the soul and the spirit.
Amen.
Is able to divide between the bone and the marrow and the thoughts and the intent of the heart.
Okay. There it is. So, he has that surgical cutter. That he knows how to divide everybody up. There's a great division happening right now. The tribulation is beginning right now. There's a great division happening. And I'm going to show you. This division is happening. He's walking through. He's putting groups here and groups here. He's dividing everybody up right now. All right? And we could have, like I said, we could have people who believe in the rapture. And I think I missed a point there. The ones that The ones that do go in the rapture, I was gonna make a point there. Don't remember, and I'll come back to it. But yes, those who say that they're going, those who say that everybody goes, they don't go. And those who say that we're all believers in Jesus, do we all go? No. But only those who are overcomers, only those who are seeking our Father in heaven, only those who are reading their word, only those that are helping ministries, all right? Only those who are, I mean, you get the idea. If you're praying in the Spirit and you're operating the gifts, all right? I mean, you can read between the lines all you want, all right? You know if you're an overcomer, all right? I'm sure probably some people that should have made it here today, they didn't. You know, by the way, you know, I'm going to go ride my boat today. That's what I'm talking about. That's the kind of division I'm talking about now. Bible said, Yeshua said, many, many will seek the narrow path. Many will seek this path, but only a few will find it. Only a few will find it. And I said, there's a few people here. Amen. So only a few will find this path. All right? Now, interesting, I love what Lior said, that last year, oh, I love this point. It's a beautiful point you made. Last year, we had great numbers at conferences. Everybody's like, yeah. It was like 80, 100 some people. Everybody's like, oh, the blood moons. Oh, Pat, what's that guy's name again? So, oh, they talk about the Shemit, not Jonathan Kahn, but the other guy. So the 7 years is up. Biltz, right, Mark Biltz. And everybody just lined up for September last year, and everybody's just ready to go. There was so much hoopla, and then nothing happened. I tell you what happened, everything broke loose in Syria, you know. Yep. Russia moved in, you know. A lot of bad things begin to happen, all right. But after that, there was a great falling away. People are falling asleep. And now numbers are dropping, all right. And, you know, it's a sad thing, but you know what what's happening right now is that division. That's the division I'm talking about. The foolish bridesmaids are like, he's coming today, today, come on, he's coming, okay, maybe Thursday, maybe Friday, Saturday, okay, maybe next week, maybe the following week, month and on. So, the parables, you got to study the parables, you got to study the patterns, all right? I love this part here. The Bible said there'll be scoffers in the last day, lusting after their heart's meaning. They're sticking to their own deep personal beliefs, lusting after their own hearts. All right? You know, the Bible says here in 2 Peter 3, 5, that's what it says here. Knowing this first, that there shall come in the last day scoffers, walking after their own lusts, and saying, where is the promise of his coming? Where is the promise of his coming? They didn't say, where is this coming? Because all believers believe that Yeshua is coming. All right? So where is this coming? They don't say that enough. They say, where is the promise of this coming? Where is the promise he's going to take us out here as things get bad? Where is the promise going? He's going to remove us because we see ISIS getting close. We see his government falling apart. We see FEMA camps getting ready to go. We see all these things going to hell right now. Where is the promise? I thought that he's going to fulfill that promise last year. Where is the promise of this coming? It's not happening, is it, Bob? I got people giving me a hard time on my channel all the time. But you know, the thing is, that basically what they're saying is, where's the promise of his coming? Show me the Bible where the rapture is. Show me in the Bible where the rapture is. Show me that promise, Bob. I just did. I'm going to show you some more. Right? Unbelievable. Now, things are going to get really interesting here. I'm going to go into the order of the book of Revelation. I'm going from chapter 1 through chapter 7. And I'm going to show you how the book of Revelation, I believe, is laid out. That points towards us being caught away before the tribulation begins. The Bible says, we're not appointed to wrath. All right? That's right. That right there tells you we're not going to be for the wrath. Why? Because the first 3.5 years is the wrath of the Lamb. Hide us in the rocks and the cave of the rocks, fall for the day of the wrath of the Lamb has come. That's the first 3.5 years. Yeshua removes his bride, the church, and he's going to punish the people who've been persecuting and killing the Christians the last 2,000 years. His wrath comes for the first 3.5 years. Don't some people think 3.5 years is 3.5 years of peace and everything goes, you know, everything goes crazy after that. No, the whole 7 years is wrath. Right? So the wrath of the Lamb is the first 3.5 years. So guess what? The Bible said we're not pointed to wrath. Everybody say wrath.
Wrath.
The wrath of the Lamb. The Bible says wrath of the Lamb. We're not pointed to his wrath. That's right. We're not pointed to that wrath. But of course, after that, after his wrath is done, the first 3.5 years, the two witnesses are caught up, the 144,000 are caught up, and the Jewish remnant are kept safe. Then what happens? Then God comes forth, his Father in heaven comes forth. He brings his wrath now for the next 3.5 years. And he punishes all those who've been killing the Jews and persecuting the Jews and been trying to kill the Jews. And, of course, everybody else has taken the mark of the beast at that point. Okay? So now you got the wrath of the Lamb and God's wrath. Okay? And instead of, they are 3-1. So you want to argue with me, oh, because it's just God's wrath? No. They are 3-1. Elohim, yes. Hebrew Elohim, yeah. They're 3-1. Mm-hmm. So regardless whose wrath it is the wrath of Elohim. Regardless. And we are not appointed to wrath once again.
Amen?
Amen? Now, so the first three chapters of the book of Revelation, as I mentioned before, is a message of overcome. And what happens in chapter 4? I saw a door open in heaven. People, oh, that's not a rapture. Yeah, yeah, it is a rapture verse. I saw a door in heaven. I heard a voice as a trumpet say, come up hither. And instantly, I was in the spirit. And I went to the throne room. And I'm paraphrasing right now. When I went to the throne room of God, all right? Interesting, it says, on the Lord's day. The Lord's day. That's not, wasn't just some ordinary day sometime during the year. It was on the Lord's day. And we have 7 Lord's days. We have 7 days, 7 different feast days throughout the year we can choose from, all right? On the Lord's day. Just saying. It's there. I still believe it's the Feast of Trumpets, you know, but we should always be ready, because you can die at any time as well.
Amen.
Okay, this was going to get fun. So, we're going into chapter 5, all right? But actually, chapter 4, actually, I'm going to stay in chapter 4 for a second. Now, what I'm going to do here, the Lord, I've been fasting this week before I came here, and during the fast, this idea came to me. It's never been done before, okay? We've all seen simulations, golf simulations, race car simulations, aircraft simulations. Well, how many of us have actually seen a rapture simulation? I may have been a part inside a rapture simulation. Who wants to be, who wants to try this rapture simulation thing I came up with? Anybody want to try it? It's experimental. My channel is all about dreams and visions. Okay? And when people send me a dream and vision, a lot of times I'll take that dream and vision and I'll reconstruct that dream. I'll take what they said and I'll recreate the dream and I'll show it on my channel. One guy in particular, he saw the waters of Florida. He saw that the Florida was on the water in his vision. He was taken from his car to the vision, back to his car while he was driving. His house is on the water. He told me about it. He sent me a picture of his house. I said, send me the picture of your house. You can see the inside of it. And what I did, I recreated the whole thing. He said that was exactly what it looked like. Man, that video actually gets a lot of views now because that guy's on the radio station or work, stuff like that. But that's exactly what it looked like. And a lot of people, when I recreate their dream, I reformulate them. And I create a video, you can watch it on my channel. And say, man, that's exactly what my dream looked like. And then they get a better understanding because they get to watch it a few times instead of just going through it once. Then I'm doing an interpretation on the dream. So, if we're still on here. Still here?
There it is.
Okay. Let's close these window shades. I'm going to take you into a simulation now. This is going to get a little interesting, guys. for you to go into a vision, and I've been in visions, you have to start praying right now. Because in order to get the full effect of this thing, you gotta be gotta close your eyes. In a moment, I'm gonna ask you guys to stand up in a moment. Where we're gonna have to be in prayer. And the Bible said, John said, I looked and then I saw. I looked and then I saw. The vision just didn't come bam, knocked him over. He said, I looked. Which means he was praying and he said, Father, give me something. Give me something. Give me something. He said, it's over here. Where? Over here. Where? Oh, I see it. Which means he was looking. Which means now we have to look. What's going to happen? I'm going to play this video here. And it's going to feel like an earthquake in here. I'm going to simulate an earthquake. They felt this earthquake all the way upstairs. I'll turn the light a little bit. It's going to be like an earthquake in here. Yeah. Is your mic ready? You all right? Speak into it.
Yeah. Testing, 1, 2.
Okay. This would be so cool. All right. It's going to be like an earthquake in here. And you're going to have your eyes closed. And what's going to happen is I'm going to start reading the scripture. Larry's going to say... Larry's going to play the part of the archangel. Now, who knows what Michael's going to say when he comes? The Bible says that he descends from heaven with a shout, the voice of an archangel. What does the archangel say? Does anybody know? We're just talking about the Jesse. What does anybody know? He's not going to say Yeshua. He's not going to say Jesus, because Jesus is like 500 different languages. What's the one word that you think he was the universal word he will say that everybody all over the earth will understand? You ready? Hallelujah. Or hallelujah. You hear people say, hey, since you're doing this, hallelujah. And, oh, I understood that part.
Right.
So I'm safe to say he's going to say hallelujah. Okay? So the Bible says what's going to happen is when our Lord descends with a shout, we'll go up in a shout. Okay? The day of trumpets, the day of blowing, the day of shouting. God shout. Now, you guys got to let your minds go now. As the scene begins, just pretend it's really happening. You're going to close your eyes. All right? And you're going to pretend you're walking through a park. You're hanging out with your family. Hanging out with loved ones. And all of a sudden, the rapture is going to take place. And when I say, and here's the cue for you guys, right? When you guys say hallelujah, open your eyes. And look at the screen. Okay? And when you guys say hallelujah, is when I say, and then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up, caught up. When I say caught up, caught up. As soon as I start saying caught up, you guys say hallelujah. I'll just say caught up once. All right. I'll say, so let's practice right now. So when then the dead Christ arise first, then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up.
Hallelujah.
And we shall meet them in the air, and I'll go into it after that. When you say hallelujah, open your eyes, watch the screen. Then, when we get to the throne room, now, if you're going for praying, if you guys, because someone here might go to the actual throne room, so get ready for it. If you go into a vision right now, you're in a safe place. Nothing's going to happen to you. We're not going to bother you, okay? But when you go to the throne room, we're going to see the throne room. You're going to see it. You're going to see Yeshua sitting on his throne. In that time, I'm going to pretty much stay quiet at that point. Because I want you guys to say to yourself, actually pretend that you're actually there. We're no longer in the hotel room. We are before the throne. We have been caught up to the throne room. I'm going to let the music play and just worship. We're going to worship. You can sing. You can speak in tongues. You can praise. You can say hallelujah. You can do whatever you want. You can dance. I don't care. All right, and then I'm gonna let that finish. And once that's done, then I'll go into chapter 5. All right, so let's hope I get this thing right here. Okay, I get a little bit of light in here. So everybody, stand on your feet. Stand on your feet. Stand to your feet. Okay. Close your eyes. So our praying Father in heaven, we pray now that your Holy Spirit begins to fill everybody here. Father, we pray now to reveal whatever you choose to reveal now, Holy Spirit. Reveal, show everybody here who you are choosing to show, or show everybody. Fill them right now and take us in to this simulation now. We are excited about your coming. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Amen. And now, go to your place. You're with your family, hanging out. Guys with your families now? For the Lord shall descend from heaven with a shout.
Hallelujah!
Then Christ shall rise first. And we who are alive remain shall be caught up. Hallelujah!
Hallelujah!
Hallelujah! And so shall we ever be with the Lord. And now, Yeshua is now taking us to the throne room. Say goodbye. We'll see you in 7 years. We'll see you in 7 years. And now we're entering into the third heaven. We're about to enter up to the sea of glass. Behold! And now we're standing before the throne room now. You guys can have a seat now. Thank you. Now, we're standing. Now, I use this as a great example because of Yeshua standing here right now. We're on the sea of glass right now. This carpet right now, I want you to pretend this is a sea of glass right now. We're standing on it. We're sitting, but we're standing. All right? For me to help you to understand how the book of Revelation is laid out, you got to understand the common sense behind it. What better way is to actually go there and see it for yourself? Okay? So now we are standing on the sea of glass. and Yeshua is about to start opening the seals. Okay? As Hebrews, like I said, 12:23. But we have come to Mount Zion, unto the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem. So now we're actually at the heavenly Jerusalem. We're before his throne. Now we're at his throne at this point. Innumerable amount of angels. The angels are surrounding us right now at this point. So we have angels all along this wall and all around us, all above us right now. And there are probably billions of us here right now. From all the dead, resurrected saints and those who are living on the earth. Okay? So I want you to picture that. Now, here's a verse that says here that nobody was able to open up the scroll. Nobody was able to open up that scroll. Here's the scroll. No one in this room was worthy to open up the scroll. John was upset. Everybody's upset. Here's the scroll. No one can open it. And then he said, there's one that can open it. It's the Lamb that was slain. He can open the scroll. So now he has the scroll. Pretend the scroll's in his hand now. Now it's interesting, once again, about the tribulation, about the pre-tribulation, the church. The church, once again, the bride of Christ, the church. All right? Once again, going back to the wrath of the Lamb is happening on the earth now. All right? The bride has been removed. You guys ever studied how a will works in ancient times? It's a will. It's Yeshua's will. That's what he has in his hand right now. I totally believe this. He has a will in his hand right now. Now, they found the old scroll, and it belonged to a very rich person. And what they did, it had seven seals on it. Leather, 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 and a big ball of wax, and they sealed the signet ring. Seven witnesses had to seal this scroll. So if I had a lot of money, I'd have to have seven people that I loved and trusted to come to me, and I made this will for my beneficiary. You see it, so everybody here at this table, seal, 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 all you guys, all right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, well, you have 8 here, right? Oh, 7, yes. So pretend all you guys had sealed. So it's a seal in here, it's a seal, 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 all right? The representation of the seven people at this table right now, you see it, right? Seven people, and this for example, what you look at here is the church, because there are seven churches. Seven messages of overcome, chapters 1, 2, 3, all right? Seven witnesses, all right? So, see the parallel starting to come now? So now Yeshua, he writes his will, he writes his own will. He seals it with seven churches, okay, this bride. Then Yeshua dies. His father raises him up, and now he gets to open his own will. You guys get it? Jesus writes, Yeshua writes his will, and he makes himself the beneficiary of his will. So if I want to write a will, I'll make myself the beneficiary. I'm going to die, and the father will raise me back up. I just open it back up. I'm the beneficiary. I get my stuff. I got to have my seven witnesses. So Yeshua standing on the throne here right now, he's about to open those seven seals that the book of Revelation talks about. What does he need? He needs the seven witnesses in heaven to open it. So the Lord shall descend from heaven with a shout. The Lord said, "Organ, the dead Christ were risen, the living were raised, and now the seven witnesses are in heaven now to open, watch the opening of the seven seals." People say, we're in the seals right now. No, we're not. We're seeing signs of the seven seals.
Come on. Yeah.
We're not seeing the seven seals. Guys, these horses are let loose. All right? A third of the earth dies. We got 8 billion people on this earth, and I haven't seen one single event yet that's killed about 3 billion people at one time. Have you? I don't watch the news that much. I watch Pastor Paul's channel to get all my news information. I check his channel first, and I go to the other one. Then I get caught up my news, and then I go everywhere else. Thank you, Pastor Paul. So, the church is in heaven at this point. All right? And the seals have not been broken yet. Oh, now they said, oh, there's, we saw this, we saw the green horse. The green horse was a manifestation. You guys ever seen the green horse in was it Syria, Iraq, Egypt? And he was, and showed the green horse is manifesting itself. They see an explosion happen, the green horse takes off. It's a demon spirit. Demons can shapeshift, they can make themselves appear. And they're trying to confuse everybody right now. Say, hey, you know what? I got a great idea. You know what you should do? If they mention two demons, like, hey, you know what you do? You should go pretend to be the green horse, manifest yourself. That's why everybody gets their numbers all off. And think we're in the seals now. That's a great idea. So he goes and makes himself a green horse and starts fooling everybody. Then you got another guy that flies a black balloon horse through the sky. But they thought some guy that was Arabia, where was that? Saudi Arabia. But they see the black horse flying. They're doing all kinds of stupid stuff. But ain't it just like Satan? Always trying to copy what the Lord is doing. We always get the counterfeit first. Then we get the real deal.
Yeah.
And we got the counterfeit coming right now. And then we'll get the real deal. Alright? So now, we're in heaven. And chapter of Revelation 5, 9. And they sung a new song. Saying, thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof. And thou wast slain and redeemed. Everybody say redeemed.
Redeemed.
Redeemed us to God by that blood out of every kindred, tongue, people, and nation. That's the church. It wasn't just the Jews. That's every kindred, tongue, people, and nation. That's everybody. Key word here is redeemed. What did Yeshua say in Matthew? He says, when he said that once you see all these signs, look up for your redemption. Draws near. Everybody say redemption.
Redemption.
That's where we're at. Redemption. What's that redemption? Oh, it's redemption of my spirit. No. He's talking to people that are already born again. Your spirit's already born again. Your spirit's already born again.
Yeah.
So if I'm Yeshua and I'm addressing you, Larry, I say, I know that my spirit is within you. Your spirit is redeemed now. But I say, look up, Larry, when all these things come to pass, look up, Larry, for your redemption draws near. You're like, okay, well, all right. What's going to be redeemed? Your body.
Amen.
Your body's going to be redeemed now.
Yeah.
Bible says he stood before the first and remember in Hebrews 12:22, it said, and to the spirits of the righteous men made perfect. Righteous made perfect. So once again, your body has been taken up to heaven. Parallels, precepts, all right? You got to stack these things to create doctrine. These are parallels for the pre-tribulation rapture. What I showed you right there about the scroll in heaven, the scroll, that is a parallel, okay? And now, let's see here. Get ahead of myself here. So now, since we have now been redeemed, I'd like to share with you, I'm out of time. I'm just going to go left here. Okay, so my son had a dream, and I've been praying, he's 8 years old now. He had a dream, and I've been praying for both my sons. I have my son 8 and the other one 7. I prayed for them to have, both of them begin having dreams. My oldest began having dreams. After months of praying, it started to happen. And he said, Father, Dad. The dad, I had a dream. Young boy, okay. This was his dream. I'll play for you. I got a quick clip of it. But I want to show you guys something about this dream. This is incredible. I put on my channel and people are just blown away by this dream. It's incredible. I'm going to say some key words. You guys are going to get it. All right? You guys know the word. You're going to get it. He said in his dream that first dream he had, whereas everything was on fire outside. Tanks are coming down the street. Then everything's falling apart around the earth. And then he hears a trumpet. He doesn't know about the trumpets. He hears a trumpet. And then he sees angels, tons of angels coming down to get all of us. And me and my family are standing outside in front of our house. And then he said, Dad, then a chariot of fire came down. He got his chariot of fire and took a whole family to heaven. He calls them fire horses. It wasn't white horses, Dad. They were fire horses. God, I was talking about what will return. The white horse. No, these are fire horses, Dad. I was like, that's incredible. Then he goes, then we went to heaven. And Dad, I saw you at the feet of Jesus. Now, Jesus has holes in his feet. He died on the cross. Grace originated with Yeshua. He said, Dad, you had your hands on, remember the 8-year-old saying this, Dad, you had your hand, you're on your knees, you had your hands on the feet of Yeshua, and you said grace. What does that mean? And I said, oh my goodness. And then, from that dream, he goes into another one he has later. Him and a bunch of his friends are playing outside at school with children. And then another trumpet blast. And then a light came down from heaven. And they all began to put their hands up. And then they were taken up to heaven. And he said that everybody there, oh, by the way, before I forget, but actually the first dream, he also dreamt that we are actually coming back to earth on the horses to destroy the enemies of God on the earth. This is really cool, the return of Christ. But then he goes on to say in the next dream that we were in the midst of our recess, light came down, and then there was a trumpet blast, and then we were taken up, and then he said that we were all singing. But he got confused at this point, so you know what? He's heard Christian music before, but he said, no. He's like, but the song we were singing, it was kind of new. I don't understand. It was a new song. What does the word say? We will sing a new song. When he opens up those seals, we will sing a new song. This is when we're standing before the throne room. And he said, we're going to sing a new song. Now, I'll show you a quick clip here. Now, since I said that, I might have to, here. We'll step out of the throne room for a minute. This is Gavin, all right, and I want him to actually share with you his dreams. You hear straight from the horse's mouth. But the thing is, before Gavin started having these dreams, a few months ago, I was praying to our Father in Heaven that my sons will begin to have dreams of the end times. And come to find out, he answered my prayers, and Gavin here has begun having these prophetic dreams.
He's having fun.
And they're going to get you really excited because they deal with some of the things that's happening right now and how it ties into the two witnesses that are coming on the scene soon. That's why we're having all this apocalyptic weather. So I'm going to show you how his dream actually ties in to the two witnesses, how I believe there's a parallel, and how his dream here parallels the rapture of Elijah. So I'll give Gavin the mic here now and let him share his own personal dreams with you guys while I kind of just sit here and hang out with him.
So this is what happened. Like, when I was at home, I heard something outside, and when I looked out, I saw like a massive tanks everywhere, and it was total destruction. But when I heard a horn, I put my hand up and I saw angels come down for us all. When I moved to heaven, I actually saw, well, it was not really white horses this time. It was fire horses. So then when we went to heaven, my dad, who touched his, hold on to his foot and said grace. Then when we were on the horses again, we went to destroy earth. So he destroyed everybody that was not good, that doesn't follow him. If you don't listen to him, you are going to really have a bad life in time. A horrible life. Trust me, you should do everything you can to follow him, or bad things will happen to you.
Now, tell him about the dream you had when all you and all your friends were at school. What happened? You got a dream about that.
So when I was walking down for recess, then when everybody got down, we all saw a light came down, like a light, a big light. Then we all, like, this is what happened. When everybody, like, sang, like, a Jesus song, I don't know what kind, it was kind of, like, new a little bit.
Yeah.
Like, and this is what happened. Like, then I put my hand out, and I was starting to tear. wasn't because of the sun. I was happy that was gonna happen. Then, when I went up, something strange I saw on the ground. And I don't feel like I would never want to have it. As I went up, I saw money on the ground, and I did not know why. And that's what happened. And I don't feel like I didn't even care about it. I just went up to heaven.
Amen. He saw money on the ground. Those are the people of the red hole. They're all about the world. They're not concentrating on our Father in heaven. Interesting. And I get dreams and visions like these things all the time. And I've had my own. I wish I could sit up 3 hours and talk about it. Just go to my channel. All right. And by the way, if I'm moving too fast, I'm going through some stuff real quick here. I'm actually going to post this on my channel. All right. Somebody recorded this or no? Okay. Good deal. If I can get a copy, that'd be great. Okay. Now, so here we are. I want to take you back here now, okay? So get the picture of what I'm trying to go to my next point here. Okay. Let's see here. So here we are. We're at the throne room now. Now, as the horses start going out, the four horsemen start going out, they start killing. A lot of people are going to start dying. A lot of people. The 3 billion. You got your 3 billion people will start dying. All right, and you're going to have all the Antichrist. You're going to have all the Christians start getting killed, start getting beheaded at this point. All right, and now remember, guys, we are standing on a sea of glass. You can see underneath the throne. There's the throne. You can see underneath it now. We've been concentrating on shooting these four horsemen all the time. Then all of a sudden, because the Book of Revelation is in chronological order. Now we go to chapter 6, the four horsemen are released, and then it goes from 6, Revelation 6, 9, 11, and said, when he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and the testimony which they held. So now, look under the altar, you see all these people appeared there now. They're under the altar. They're not above the altar. They're not in line with the altar. We're in line with the altar right now. But they're under the altar. Why is that? Well, there's a bunch of different reasons why, but the Bible says that they're crying out, "Faithful Lord, faithful and true, when will you avenge our blood?" He said, "Rest until your number is fulfilled." The number you are going to die. There is a number that's going to be reached. All right, and I believe in chapter 7, verse 9. I believe that number is fulfilled. Some people may not think, but here's why. Because he says in Revelation chapter 7, verse 9, it says this. After this beheld, lo, a great multitude, another great multitude now. I thought we were the first great multitude, chapter 5. So we have this great multitude here. Then we have a great multitude down there. Mm-hmm. Then the next chapter, then after that, behold, a great multitude, which no man can number, of all nations. All kindreds, people, tongues stood before the throne. Not under the throne, before the throne now. Now we're all before the throne. So what happens? Those saints came up. They got taken up the rest of the way. And now they're with us. Before the throne. And no longer under it. And they stood before the throne of the Lamb and clothed with white robes. And they had palm branches in their hand. They cried out loud voice saying, "Salvation to our God, which sitteth upon the throne and unto the Lamb." Now, we all have palm branches. We didn't have palm branches in chapter 5, but we got them in chapter 7 now. So everybody start waving their palm branches, go, now we're at chapter 7. Amen? Amen? And now, at this point, why do I think that's a number of the fulfillment of the church being fulfilled at that point? All the tribulation saints are killed because that number was complete at that point. And then at chapter 7, the number is complete, and now they can come up and be with us now, all together. Because at that point, what happens? There's a shift.
Hallelujah.
There's a shift right there. Chapter 7. Guys, the seventh seal is not a judgment. The sixth seal is a massive judgment. The seventh seal is a transition. There's always the seventh seal, the seventh vial. It's a transition. It's not a judgment. It's a transition. All right? And now, the transition at this point is Yeshua I'm gonna make it real simple. Yeshua say, I have my entire church here now. Those of you that were resurrected and have your mortal bodies, and those of you who are resurrected, those of you who have died for me in the tribulation state, you're all before me now. This is him speaking. You're all before me now. Those of you who have, you don't have your bodies yet, you will receive your bodies when we return to earth. Okay? And now what happens? The focus changes. 3.5 years is over, and now God says, his father says, congratulations, son, your bride's here. Now it's my turn. Now we're 3.5 years in. He said, now I'm bringing my wrath, and we're shifting our focus on Israel now. Only Israel. I believe at halfway through the tribulation, when it comes, if you're a Gentile, if you're not a Jew, if you're a Gentile, one of two things are going to happen. Either you got to die for the Lord, or you're just going to die. Or you're going to take the mark of the beast. Because there's no talk about Gentiles being redeemed after this point. There's only those who are getting redeemed and saved is the Jewish nation. It's kind of eerie to think about. Okay? So, now we go to the two witnesses. At this point, the two witnesses are coming on the scene. The two witnesses actually started at the beginning of the tribulation, the first 3.5 years. Now, you guys want a simple answer to why I think that we're not going to be in the tribulation? Simple answer? Well, the thing is, the two witnesses, they show up to preach to the Jews. I'll tell you something. If I hear about two men showing up in Israel, covered in sackcloth, and they're pouring fire down from the sky preaching to the Jews, I'm going to Israel. I don't know about Pastor Paul, but I take a ton of people to Israel. We're all going to Israel. You know, forget the 144,000. You're going to have 144 million people flooding into Israel to see the two witnesses. All right? There won't be a single Jew hearing their message from at least a quarter mile around these guys because we're going to be gathering them. Why would God send two witnesses here to preach the gospel when he has us here right now? That's just it. We're not going to be here no more. So now he's going to send the two witnesses to preach. And then after the two witnesses come, the Bible says in Revelation 14, there's an angel of the Lord that comes to the everlasting gospel. And he preaches. You ever wonder why he sends an angel at this point? Because everybody's getting killed for the gospel. This angel can preach anywhere in an instant, and nobody can kill him. All right, so you have the two witnesses here. And that's kind of funny because I know if we all go to Israel, those two witnesses aren't going to be able to do anything at all. I'll be honest, man, if I went to Israel and say, hey, Elijah, man, I read about you all my life, man, come over here, is that Enoch, or is that Moses with you, man? Oh, man, you're incredible. Hey, man, hey, tell me about how it was when you went up against the prophets of Baal. That was incredible. Hey, how was it going up in the chariot of fire? Oh, that's, you know, no, never mind, they just laid a rod on me. That was something that double portion. Woo! and Elijah would be like, man, leave me alone. That's exactly what it's going to be like. So we can't be here for that. You guys ever wonder the order of preaching the gospel? I kind of received this too. The order of preaching the gospel, this is the only reason why I also believe that we're not going to be here. The gospel originates with our Father in heaven. One. Goes to the Old Testament prophets, Moses. Two. And then there's silence for a while. 400 years, give or take. Yeshua shows up. Three. Yeshua ascends to heaven. Church takes over. Now we're preaching the gospel. Four. Church leaves, and the church age ends. Two witnesses takes over. Five. They start preaching. They die. They're resurrected. The angel takes over. Revelation chapter 14. Six. And then it ends. Well, Bob, shouldn't it end at seven? Is it seven the perfect number, right? No. On the seventh day, he rested. Interesting parallel there, once again. Okay? So, let's see here. Where am I at? Here's another parallel I can show you about the two witnesses as well. The two witnesses, when they show up, they're going to walk the life of Christ. They're going to walk. Everything they do will parallel. And this is where I believe the 144,000 are going to be taken up at this point. This is what I believe, because I'm looking at the parallels. Everybody wants to know, when does 144,000 show up? Well, here you have Yeshua and the two witnesses. Yeshua, humble, born in the manger, all right, carpenter, all right. The two witnesses covered in sackcloth. Yeshua's ministry 3.5 years. Two witnesses ministry 3.5 years. Yeshua preached the gospel, preached the truth. The two witnesses are going to preach the gospel, and they will preach the truth. Yeshua is going to be hated by the religious. Yeshua was hated by the religious. The two witnesses will be hated by the religious. Yeshua was loved by some. The two witnesses will be loved by some. Yeshua performed miracles. The two witnesses will perform miracles. They're going to pull fire out of the sky. They're going to stop the heavens and pull all kinds of miracles. All right? You guys getting these parallels? I can keep going. Okay? And then, Yeshua fled from death many times. He walked away in the midst of them. He's about to get pushed off a cliff. He said, I'm done. Walks away. Incredible. The two witnesses, they'll flee from death all the time. Anybody tries to hurt, you call a fire down from the sky and consumes their enemies. They'll flee death until it's their time to die. Just like Yeshua had his time to die. Yeshua, killed by the religious, the high priest. The two witnesses will be killed by the Antichrist. Yeshua, dead for 3 days, resurrected. The two witnesses, dead for 3 days, and then resurrected. Here's the point. At Yeshua's resurrection, what happened? There was a great earthquake. And the stones and the graves opened. And the resurrected Old Testament saints came up, all of them. Right? There's nobody left in earth right now. They're all in heaven. And they all came up, and they walked into the city. The Bible says it. Right? And when the two witnesses go up, the Bible says there's a great earthquake. Once again. Now here's the point I want to make. Yeshua raised on the third day, which is first fruits. He fulfilled that day. At that day, when he was resurrected, no more than a mile down the road, at this point, first of all, he walked, he saw the women saw him, Mary saw him, okay? He said, don't touch me, I have not ascended to my Father yet. He has not fulfilled first fruits yet. But that morning, just a mile down the road at the temple, you have a high priest come away, a sheaf of barley, take it to the temple, wave it before the temple, then he slaughters the lamb. He waves before God, then he slaughters the lamb. Yeshua ascended into heaven. He took those saints with him, and then presented himself before his Father with the resurrected saints as the first fruits. Okay? Because the Bible said after that point, when Yeshua ascended into heaven, he was taken to a cloud. It wasn't the clouds. It was a cloud. Those saints came down, and when Yeshua came up, they met, which is a picture of the rapture. The Bible said we'll meet them in the air. The saints did not go up with him at the public ascension when he ascended before 500 people. He met them. Right? So interesting area. So now here we are with that. But now let's look at the two witnesses. The two witnesses walked the same way as Yeshua. And they died and were resurrected in their mortal bodies. And then he went up. And then what happened? That same hour there was a great earthquake. And at that point, everybody that was following those two witnesses said, I believe you're going to have 144,000 raptured from the earth, taken with them at that point. And that's when 144,000 come. Why? Because the wrath of the Lamb, once again, the 3.5 years, you guys got to get this. The 3.5 years of the Lamb is over. We're now going into the 3.5 years of the wrath of God. God is starting to complete his wife. When you learn, Pastor Larry, to talk about that, the 144,000 is the first fruits unto God for his wife. God's wife, not the church who is the wife of Yeshua. We're talking about the wife of Yahweh, the wife of Yahuwah. Okay? And then, this is kind of cool right here. I can finish up right here. I'll bring this up right here. How much time I got left? There. Dang. Yeah, that's true. Would it be okay if I could finish up with you?
Yeah,
all right.
Sure.
You can help me through.
Yeah.
Okay.
That'd be great.
But I want to go into what's some things I can talk about here. I don't want to talk about that right now, and I don't want to talk about that right now. So why don't we take a break? So thank you guys. I got some visuals I'll show you later, but I'll team up with Pat later. In fact, what I'm going to be talking about actually ties into what he's going to be talking about.
I'll let you go just a little bit first and you can finish up.
Or you can just help me all the way through it, too. You know, want to know. But, yeah. So let me take a break for now. Thank you guys very much. Elohim, bless you. Hang in there. We're almost finished.
Yeah.
Hold on one second. Okay, for those of you that are watching again by live stream, remember you guys, we really don't have a schedule today. This is all the Holy Spirit, so we will take a few minute break. What time is it? 11:34. So I have sent a text or a message to Brother Stephen, Rabbi Stephen. He's like the absent-minded from FAFSA. And so, but he's always Skyped in or even been present. So hopefully he will Skype in at, 11:45. If he doesn't for any reason, what I'm going to do is just give you guys that time to just go and refresh yourselves. And then we will come back at... let's see. So he had 11:45 to 12. We'll come back at 1 o'clock. See, most people don't know because they've already left. So if you guys happen to see the brothers and sisters in the hallway, just let them know. We will resume at 1 o'clock if Brother Stephen does not Skype in at 11:45. Okay, so those of you that are on live stream, you guys go get your little break and stuff like that. We'll see you soon. God bless you guys. And hold on. Hopefully he'll Skype in. I'm going to try and Skype him in a little bit. So you guys go ahead and do your break. And then just come back just shortly before 11:45. And hopefully I'll have Brother Stephen up. Can somebody open up the curtains for me? Thank you. No, then we're just going to give people a break to just go and rest for a little bit. I know and then we'll come back and resume.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
you. That was awesome, actually. Okay, so for those of you that are watching right now on the live, I need to cut the video and I need to make sure that we will be able to get a hold of Brother Stephen. I have to Skype him. So what I need you to do, those of you watching here, go over to my website, hamishkandavi.org, and then just hang on for a little bit and you're going to click on my website. You're going to click on Pastor Paul Begley's live stream, and hopefully again we can get him live at 11:45 here, but it won't be here, it'll be on Pastor Paul's live stream. So again, go to the website hamishkandavi.org in about 10 minutes or so. If you don't see us here, it's because we've got Brother Stephen DeNoon and he will be live Skyping here. You will be able again to click on live stream for Pastor Paul and you will be able to watch the conference from Pastor Paul. Okay, we will see you guys very shortly. God bless you. Be right back.